I'm Chisgool Gaming, and over 82,000 people watched my original guide on Sun Tzu back when my commanders looked like this. We've come a long way and have for you some of the very best talents in the game to get the most out of your Sun Tzu, so stick around for this full commander guide talking about the best uses for Sun Tzu in 2020 and beyond. Hello, my friends, and welcome back. Today, we're talking about what is possibly one of the very best epics in Rise of Kingdoms. That is Sun Tzu. We are going to give you the very best talents available to kick butt with this commander. If you like Rise of Kingdoms guides that help you get value and smash your enemies by getting the most out of your commanders, consider subscribing to the channel for daily Rise of Kingdoms videos. We're a sponsored content creator, and this has to be one of the very best epics in Rise of Kingdoms. We have spent so much time using this commander, and far and away, for just about anything you're going to do, defending your garrison, battling in the field, heck, you could even rally with this commander, Sun Tzu slices, dices, and does it all. We're going to have timestamps in the description so you can jump to whatever part of the video you want. However, in the front end, we're going to talk about what makes Sun Tzu such a good commander in this game. Then we're going to talk specifically about his skills, giving you a detailed breakdown so you understand exactly how they work. We're going to give you the best talent builds available for Sun Tzu, and we have literally more than half a dozen hyper-focused on all the different things you might want to go do. We're going to talk about how you unlock and max out this commander. And of course, last but far from least, we'll talk about the pairings. And spoiler alert, yeah, Sun Tzu's good with basically everybody. Let's start by talking about what makes Sun Tzu such a good commander in 2020 and beyond in Rise of Kingdoms. First and foremost, he does area of effect damage. Area of effect damage is very critical in many game modes of Rise of Kingdoms. That includes Kingdom versus Kingdom. That includes Ark of Osiris. Heck, it even includes good old-fashioned Kingdom Wars. If you're looking for an effective commander in the open field, Sun Tzu has the area of effect damage that you're looking for, and it's paired with Rage Generation. Now, Rage Generation is very powerful. The way that active skills work in Rise of Kingdoms is that you have to generate rage. When you have enough rage, you use these super powerful skills. Well, Sun Tzu makes you generate more rage, and that is very good, no matter who you pair this commander with. Sun Tzu also reduces damage taken, which is very, very powerful, and a part of why Sun Tzu is still good in 2020 is that he is not specific to any one type of troop. Yes, his third skill gives 10% infantry health, but almost everything he's doing does not care about what type of troop you bring to the battlefield, which means he's very flexible and good for things like defending your city, where you will have lots of different troops in the battle. It is these things that make Sun Tzu so good in 2020 and beyond. Area of effect damage, rage generation, doesn't care about the troop type. What he's missing is march speed, but that's something that we can solve for and something you're not going to care about if you're defending your city because he should already be there. Let's review very briefly these skills that he brings to the battlefield to make sure we all understand how they work because they are different than you might expect. The active skill, when you have the expertise on this commander, is going to do a direct damage factor of 800 to up to 5 targets. Now, I want to call attention to the fact that the reality is you will rarely hit more than 3 targets, and more common is just going to be 1 or 2. You do an additional damage factor of 200 to each target on the next turn. So it's really a combined damage factor of 1,000 per target, which is really great. You hit one target, that's like 1,000 damage factor. You hit two targets, 2,000 damage factor, and so on. The more targets you hit, the better this gets, and you generate an additional 50 rage by each target hit by this skill. You hit five targets, that's 250 rage. Realistically, you're only going to hit one or two, that's 50 to 100 rage. Sun Tzu's second skill is Gangbuster. It reduces damage taken by the garrison by 7%. Now look, you're going to see a lot of things in this game that increase your attack, increase your defense, a few things will increase your health. And health is the best stat in Rise of Kingdoms. Card up in the top if you haven't seen my video. You can always watch that at the end of this video. 7% troop damage reduction is a very powerful effect that is hard to find. Among all the epic garrison commanders, I would argue that this is the best garrison skill by far that they've got. Now, the next skill is going to take it even further with 10% additional damage taken reduction. And yes, these things stack additively, so that's 17% total from his skills. And it also gives you 10% infantry health. Health is the best stat because it's one of the hardest to find. And quite frankly, 10% health is nice, but not that much. So you can use this commander with other troop types other than infantry, and he'll still do great. The final skill increases active skill damage by 20%. Now, active skills have to be the first skill over here on every commander. It will increase the primary and secondary commander, and it's not going to increase the damage by 20%. If you do 1,000 damage when you look at the amount of damage you do to the enemy, do not think of this as doing now 1,200 damage. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't account for all of the things that boost your own damage and the enemy reduces the damage taken. We found that it was more like an 11% observed boost after you factor in the enemy's defense and your attack and all the other bonuses and things that are happening in combat. If you'd like to see a detailed video where we explain exactly how that works, I've got a card up in the top where we demonstrate how that stacking works exactly. Now, we've already talked about the expertise skill with this commander as a part of the active skill. It is boosting the amount of damage that you deal and the number of targets that you can hit. It's really the amount of damage you deal that I'm most interested in with the expertise skill on Sun Tzu. The amount of rage gained doesn't change. Hitting more targets, honestly, you're rarely going to hit more than 3 targets. Very, very rarely. It's really all about that extra damage, and the fact that there is rage gen here at all. Now that we've talked about these skills, let's go get a look at the talents. The thing that you're probably the most excited about, I've got at least like 5 or 6 different builds for this commander, and they're all very exceptional, very finely tuned to help you use this commander to the max, and we've used him a lot. Now, he is an infantry garrison and skill commander. This is very, very good as a combination of talent trees to have available. The garrison tree is exceptional for defending structures. The skill tree is exceptional for generating rage and dealing damage. The infantry tree is good when you're using only infantry. And it's particularly good in the open field because it's got a lot of march speed and march speed reduction. Getting a look at a few of the talent builds, the first one that I want to show you is a build that is designed for Canyon. Lost Canyon, Sunset Canyon. This build removes all march speed. It removes all march speed reduction. I've basically taken all of the movement speed related things that I do not care about in a game mode like Canyon, and focuses in on exactly how you use this commander if you don't have to worry about getting to where you're going. This build generates tons of rage, does tons of damage, and if you were going in and creating this incrementally as you level this commander up, start by going to Rejuvenate, then go to Feral Nature, then make your way to Hold the Line, and also Undying Fury, Strong of Body, pick up Iron Spear and Latent Power at the very tail end of things. The next build we're going to go get a look at is for defending a flag. If you're a garrison captain for your alliance and you're defending a flag, this could be a structure in Ark of Osiris. This build is really exceptional if you can bring full infantry and expect your alliance members to only contribute infantry. Otherwise, you're not going to get the benefit of Hold the Line. If you're leveling up a commander and incrementally skilling them up here, I would focus first on Rejuvenate, which generates a ton of rage every time you use an active skill, both for the primary commander when they use their skill and the secondary commander when they use theirs. So it's 120 rage every cycle of active skills. I really like Kingsguard. Giving 3% of each stat for all troop types is gangbuster for defending flags. I have taken extra damage reduction. I've also gone in and focused on infantry. I assume that if you're defending a flag, you really can get full infantry to that party. And if you can have full infantry, you're really going to want both of these things, which benefit you by having lots of infantry present. Now, if you're an Ark of Osiris garrison captain for your alliance, and you really wanted to specialize to win in that game mode, this is a build that I think is very exceptional. It goes all the way over to pick up Know Thy Enemy, which increases damage reduction effects by 9%. Some people hypothesize that this is not as good as it might seem because of the wording, but it is, I think, an additional 9% damage reduction. If you want to see a detailed breakdown when we proved that, sort of, card up in the top where we talk about your city getting swarmed. Now, this build is good for Ark of Osiris because the Kingsguard talent doesn't work for defending your city. It focuses on reducing damage taken, it assumes your structures will get swarmed, it generates rage, it does lots of damage, and it doesn't invest very much in infantry at all, because the reality is you'll probably have a mix of troops defending that structure. Now, if what you want to do is defend your city, I think this is a very, very exceptional build. We've tested this pretty extensively. I think if you're worried about getting swarmed, and most people should be, Know Thy Enemy is very good. Once you hit about 45 million power, that's when you should be more concerned about a single rally than getting swarmed down. So up until about 40 to 45 million power, this is the build that I would recommend that you use. It is very powerful for defending your city, and you, of course, can test this yourself. In the Expedition game mode, you can see how exactly this build performs. It's not exactly the most realistic scenario when they have these sort of city attack events in that Expedition game mode, but it's a pretty close approximation, and it'll give you directional sense of whether or not this is the sort of build that works for you. Spoiler alert, this is a really good one. There is, of course, one other city defense build that you could go with. Let me show you what that looks like by crafting it now. This build is what I used to recommend that people use for defending your city. If you are over 45 million power and you're still using Sun Tzu as the primary on your wall, and honestly, you probably should be in most cases, then yes, I think this build is very good if what you're worried about is most likely a single rally and maybe some amount of swarming to go with it. It focuses in on generating lots of rage and doesn't get any of these points that would require you to be surrounded in order to get their full benefit. I like this build, again, for city defense if you're worried about a rally only, or if you're just not sure if you're going to get swarmed, right? Like, this is the anti-swarm, this is the anti-single rally. The last build we need to show you is an open field build for Sun Tzu. If you're using him as the primary to fight in the open field, the build we're about to show is the one I would go with. This is the build I would recommend for battling in the open field. Although the Canyon build we showed you earlier didn't care about march speed, we flip the script with this build and we say, you know what? If you're battling in the field, you really need to get to and from fights very, very quickly, both to avoid unfavorable situations and to deliver serious punishment. I like the huge amount of march speed we're getting from all of these talent points on the right-hand side of the tree. I like that we are trying to slow the enemy, and even this one point over here in health is very purposeful because health is the best stat in the game. It's going to reduce the number of wounded troops that you ultimately have. All stats sort of help with that, but health will do the most to that effect. We also generate lots of rage from Rejuvenate, and quite frankly, this is the first talent I would go and pick up for open field fighting before I would even make my way up top toward elite soldiers. From there, I'd get the talents that are off to the side from the main path, getting fleet of foot, strong of body, tactical mastery, and so on. Now, the main difference between these two builds is that if you're not a big T5 player, you want to use the march speed for sure. If you are a T5 player, you can get away with using this Canyon build in the open field because honestly, like, you're not running away from fights, you're the one delivering the pain in the fights, the big pain, and so you don't quite have to worry as much about your maneuverability because you don't have to worry about getting really punished for being out of position in the same way that someone with less tech would. Now, if you are bringing full T5 to fight, I actually might still steer you toward this field build because, man, getting caught out of position with, you know, T5 troops, even if you do overpower your enemy, is going to have a massive repair build tied to it. Let's talk about the optimal skill sequence for this commander, and this is going to be pretty straightforward. If we get a look at his skills, you know that when you star up a commander, it unlocks a new skill for you to invest your sculptures into to get them to level up. My strong recommendation to you for Sun Tzu is to max the first skill before you star him up at all. From there, I think you should go in and take him to 4 stars and hope that your skills land on the 3rd or 4th skill as you skill up your commander, because they'll randomly be assigned among any non-maxed skills. The max level is, of course, 5 on any 1 skill. And this is a commander that I think should be one of the very first commanders that you expertise. If you're looking for more detailed guidance on what I think some of the best early game epic commander investments are, I've got a card up in the top for a video that's got your back. We'll give you the detailed answer to that question. The short answer is Sun Tzu should be one of those commanders. You'll unlock him from the tavern using either silver or gold keys. You'll get him as your starting commander if you pick China as your civilization. That means you'll get more sculptures of him from the quests that you complete as you move through the game. Ultimately, you'll have plenty of universals to apply to this commander, and switching civilizations to China later is not going to switch your quests over to give you more of his sculptures. So if you started with some other civilization, that's fine. Don't switch to China to try to get more of him, because it doesn't work that way. Let's talk now about the pairings for Sun Tzu, and there are so freaking many. Let's first talk about the epic commander pairs, and I'm going to say again that because he only barely cares about infantry as a troop type, if you're using him as a secondary commander, you can pair him with almost anyone. If you're using him as a primary commander, he should either be in the garrison, where you're picking mostly talents that it doesn't matter what troop type you have, or if you're using him as a primary commander, it should be with full infantry because you're using the infantry talent tree, okay? So if you use him as a primary, again, it should be a garrison situation where your build doesn't care about what troop type you have, or it should be when you bring all infantry. Because look, if you've got a bunch of infantry talents over here, and you bring some other commander or some other troop type that doesn't care about infantry, you lose a lot of benefit. But when you use them as a secondary, the only thing you're really losing is the 10% infantry health, which is not the end of the world to not have. Let's get into the epic pairings, and I'm going to share with you my top 3 pairings, because honestly, this guy could pair just about anywhere. The first that I want to mention is Olgimundok. Extremely solid. They both care about infantry. It's a very logical pairing. Doesn't matter really who's the primary. I think Sun Tzu is better in some ways because he generates more rage, but either one will be fine. If we look at Boudica, she's also exceptional as a pair. Optimally, Sun Tzu is going to be the primary because Boudica has the integration tree. It's just not that good for fighting other players. Of course, if you're fighting barbarians, use Boudica as the primary, and the area of effect damage of Sun Tzu might actually hit more barbarians, which means they'll start attacking you and they don't cost you any action points to hit. Card up in the top if you want to see exactly what I'm talking about, with area of effect damage giving you free barbarians. The last epic commander that I want to highlight is going to be Joan of Arc. Joan of Arc is amazing because she's giving massive buffs to all nearby troops. We've talked a lot about her in my other videos. The two of them together are phenomenal. Doesn't really matter who's the primary. The support tree from Joan of Arc is exceptional. If you're fighting in the open field, there's an argument to be made that Sun Tzu primary is the better pick because you can hide your Joan of Arc behind the Sun Tzu because people will focus down a Joan of Arc but are less likely to focus down a Sun Tzu. Now, a quick shout out to some of these other epics. I think you could pair with Scipio for a very tanky march. You could use that in the front line in Canyon, and it would do pretty well. Weirdly enough, if you bring full archers, you could pair with Kusunoki or with Herman, and that's shockingly effective. You can pair with full cavalry if you wanted to. Again, use the cavalry commanders as the primary, Sun Tzu as the secondary. Osman is a phenomenal pair if you what you want to do is just lots of damage. That is because Sun Tzu generates rage. Osman really wants a rage engine for the skill Sword of Osman, which will do 400 damage for the active skill of both the primary and secondary commander, in addition to his own active skill being very powerful single target damage. These two are an exceptional epic pair for doing ridiculous amounts of damage, but they do lack in march speed. You could bring full archers and pair with Kira, but honestly, most players are not going to have her expertise for a very, very, very long time. Pelagius I also skipped, but not intentionally. He is an exceptional cavalry commander. Use him as the primary, bring full cavalry, Sun Tzu secondary. You're going to generate ridiculous amounts of rage. You've even got some healing. The only thing you're missing is march speed, which you can get from the cavalry talent tree, which is why it's critical that you use Pelagius as the primary. Now, when it comes to defending your city with any of these epics and your garrison commander choices, it doesn't so much matter which one is the primary or the secondary, as long as you're choosing talents that do not care about what type of troop you bring to the battlefield. I would not recommend, again, I would not recommend a build like this for defending your city, which cares so much about one type of troop. You really need to go all in on trees like the garrison tree or the skill tree, or really a combination of the two. So with that said, as long as you've got an appropriate build, any of the other epic garrison commanders will be a fine pairing for defending your city. My general guidance, however, for the best epic pairing for defending your city against a swarm is going to be Sun Tzu with Kusunoki. Alternatively, if you think you might get rallied, you could go with Ulji Mundok with Sun Tzu to shift things slightly in favor of being anti-rally. And if you're really heavily focused on cavalry in your city's defense, pair with Pelagius. That way, not only do you have more effectiveness against a single target dealing with a rally, but you get a lot of cavalry stats, and most players do stack cavalry as the primary troop that they overtrain. Now, in terms of pairing Sun Tzu with legendary commanders, I mean, you really can pair him with almost any legendary, and it will be fine as long as he is the secondary commander. If both commanders are infantry, for example, if you're pairing with Charles Martel and Sun Tzu, then like it doesn't really matter who the primary is because they're both infantry commanders. I'll call attention to the fact that epics are a lot easier to level up, so you're more likely to have your Sun Tzu higher level than your legendary, and in that case, you are going to probably want Sun Tzu to be the primary. Now, a lot of people ask with a commander specifically like Charles Martel, when do they replace their Sun Tzu on their wall with a commander like Charles Martel? I would argue that once you get to like 5-3, that's 5 on the first skill, 3 on the second skill, the Charles Martel is already better than the Sun Tzu for defending your city. We've tested this pretty extensively, and Charles Martel is extremely good. This applies for defending flags as well. However, I will call attention to the fact that there is some advantage to having area of effect damage when you're in a flag, simply for controlling the field. And if the enemy is going to feed you lots of kills by swarming in the area around a flag, then you will get more value from a Sun Tzu than you would a Charles Martel. That is certainly the case. However, for most players that are defending their city, the question that you're really asking about is, when is the Charles Martel going to replace the Sun Tzu on your wall? I think 5-3-1-1 is good enough. However, I would also make the argument that if you also want to use your Charles Martel in the open field, you should wait till you max the first two skills before starring him up further, and then your Charles Martel will be better than your Sun Tzu for defending your city. I'm eager to hear how you use this guidance for defending your own city, for battling in the field. This guide is oriented more toward newer players in Rise of Kingdoms, so leave a comment down below if you have any further questions. I'm happy to address those. Consider subscribing to the channel for more detailed commander guides, or check out the card up in the top for another video or playlist with tons of information evaluating commanders in 2020. If you enjoyed this video, do me that favor and drop a like on it. Until next time, my friends, you have fun smashing the kingdom.